Hello, my friends. This is Pastor Dave coming to you from Evangel Pentecostal Church. Glad to have you with us as we continue our study in the book of John. We're going to be looking at John chapter 6, just a few verses today, just 6 verses, 15 to 21. This is about the storm that comes up on the Sea of Galilee. So, very interesting passage of scripture. So, let's pray as we open our Bibles. Father, I thank you for every person, Lord, taking part. Lord, this day, Lord, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would fall fresh upon them, that your word would just be illuminated before our eyes, God. And Father, may we grow, Lord, because, Lord, we're reading your word and we're growing in it, Lord, we pray. So, Lord, help us to glean, Father, what it is that you would have us learn today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, we are picking this up in John chapter 6. And again, I'm reading from the English Standard Version. And verse 15, of course, follows the account of the feeding of the 5,000 men. And it was likely, as I said, there was thousands more because it doesn't count the women and the children. So as many as 20,000 people were fed with a few loaves and a couple of fish. Now, obviously, the crowds were very aware that what was happening was a supernatural multiplication of food. They could see it before their eyes, and they were so overjoyed at what they were seeing that they immediately just wanted to make Jesus king. And this of course presents a problem for Jesus. So this is where we pick it up in verse 15. So don't forget, this is the context from where we are starting from today. Therefore, and that is of course everything that's gone on in the first 14 verses. Therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he departed again to the mountain by himself alone. So again, Jesus is still trying to get this time alone after being with the Pharisees, and that encounter that didn't go well. And now the feeding of these thousands of people, and now they want to make him king, but Jesus still wants to get alone to be with the Father. So if we go back to verse 14, we would read, truly, this is the prophet who is to come into the world. And one verse later, as we say, they want to make him king. So not just prophet, the crowds are making him king. But what they missed in this from prophet to king, what they missed is that Jesus really needed to be their high priest. That is the reason he came. Yes, he was the promised prophet. Yes, he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, but Jesus needed to be their high priest. And of course, they missed that. He would have to be the great high priest because he would be the one that what would lay down his life as a sacrifice for the sin of mankind. Thus, knowing the crowd's misconception as to who he was and what he was about, Jesus, of course, went up on the mountain to be alone, even without the disciples. He needed to be alone. He wanted this alone time that sometimes we all need. We just need to be alone with the Father. And Jesus needed this more than any of us, of course. So where are the disciples, let's ask, because Jesus has gone up on the mountain to pray. So where are the disciples? Well, I would say that no doubt they're still talking amongst themselves about the incredible miracle that's just taken part in. I mean, Jesus had them take part in it. They were the ones passing this bread out and fish. They were the ones that were seeing this food begin to multiply before their eyes. They've just witnessed one of the greatest miracles of their lives. And on top of that, they were to gather up 12 basketfuls left over. So, incredible object lesson. There was more left over than what they began with. And I'm sure they were in awe, they were in wonder about this Jesus that they had decided to follow. So the account that follows after this is also in Matthew and it's in Mark. And I'm actually going to go to Matthew and Mark because it gives us some more information that John's gospel sort of leaves out. So it's okay to go to Matthew and Mark to fill in a few more details, and that's exactly what we're going to do. So let's pick this up at verse 16, 17, and 18. Now, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into the boat, and went over the sea toward Capernaum. And it was already dark, and Jesus had not come to them. Then the sea arose because a great wind was blowing. So John's gospel tells us that the disciples had got into a boat and they were heading out to sea. We get some understanding as to why would they do this at night? Well, Matthew and Mark tell us that Jesus, quote, made the disciples get into the boat. That's Mark 6:45, Matthew 14:22, and to go ahead of him because they wanted to go back to Capernaum. That was the closest city. He didn't tell them why, neither did they know what was to lay ahead of them as they headed out to the sea, just as it was getting dusk and the wind was beginning to blow. But thankfully, they were faithful to the Lord's instructions. But notice in the text, Jesus made them do this. Now, we can only imagine why. So we would probably say, okay, what's going to happen? Why is Jesus making them do this? Because it's almost like, yeah, something's going to happen here, which we will see what happens. And so these faithful disciples, they go down to the Sea of Galilee, they get on board this boat, and they begin their journey across the lake. Now, I've been to the Sea of Galilee, I've been to Galilee, Capernaum, all these places, beautiful lake. It's about 9 kilometers across from Tiberias to the other side. It's about 9 kilometers across the lake. Now, the text tells us that what it's early evening, dark was coming, and the wind was beginning to pick up. If there's anybody listening that you've ever been out on the lake on a dark, moonless night, it's pretty scary because all you can hear is waves slapping on the boat. You can't even see the water because it's so dark. You don't know if there's rocks around. You have no idea. You can't see anything. You really don't know where you are. And it can be a very frightening experience. And as I said, making matters worse, not only was it getting dark, but the wind was beginning to pick up. And when the wind picks up, the waves pick up, and the waves are getting bigger, and now the waves are smashing on the boat. I'm sure at this point, these disciples had probably wished that they'd taken the road and walked instead of getting in the boat. But Jesus made them get in the boat, remember? Now they're being pushed off course. They're getting into the middle of the lake. And don't forget again, all this is in darkness. And what we understand is that Jesus is not just the savior in the storm, but he's also what? He's the sender of the storm. Remember, as I said, he made the disciples go by boat. So obviously, Jesus set them up for another object lesson, which we're going to get to. Now remember as well, not all of these disciples were seasoned fishermen. Peter and Simon might be holding up well. They were likely out many times on the boat during the night fishing. But they weren't all seasoned fishermen, and I'm sure many of them were terrified. Many of them were probably in fear for their lives. I'm sure they all couldn't swim. And all that's bad news. But the worst of all news for these guys is Jesus isn't with them. You know, Jesus went up on the mountain to pray. He's back on shore. He's safe. And here we are in the middle of the lake, a storm coming up in pitch black. Not very good. Now, you need to know the geography of Galilee. You will know that the Sea of Galilee is about 600 feet below sea level. The northern coast by Capernaum is very, very high hills, and then there's mountains. And when the wind comes from the north, when the wind comes over these mountains and down these hills and right down to 600 feet below sea level, the Sea of Galilee almost acts like a wind tunnel. And it churns up the lake very, very quickly. Sort of reminds me of a story I heard once about a ship that was sinking in the middle of the storm. And the captain yells out to the crew and says, does anyone know how to pray? And one man steps forward and says, yes, sir, I know how to pray. And the captain says, Wonderful. You pray while the rest of us put on our life jackets. We're one short. Verse 19. So when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near to the boat, and they were afraid. So we're now seeing where they are in the lake. They rowed about 3 or 4 miles, pretty well almost halfway across the lake at this point, what we call the point of no return, just as far ahead as it is to go back. But then to their amazement, they see Jesus. He's not in the boat. He's walking on the water. And the text tells us they were terrified. Now, the Greek here doesn't just mean that they were just fearful. It says that they were sore afraid. They exhibited exceedingly great fear. They were terrified. And who wouldn't be? Here it is, in the middle of the lake. In pitch dark, the sea is rough, the wind is howling, and you see a person walking on water as if they're out for a Sunday stroll. Again, let's go to Matthew and Mark, because they give us a few more details. Mark's gospel tells us this: about 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. He intended to go past them, but when they saw him walking on the water, they cried out in terror, thinking he was a ghost. They were all terrified when they saw him. So what's Jesus doing out in the middle of the lake at night, walking across the Sea of Galilee? The first thing is we might think, well, he must be coming to rescue the disciples. He's heard their cry, he's heard their plea. But the text does not imply that this was a rescue mission, because it says that he appeared to go past them. So there was a greater purpose. And truly, they had been set up for another object lesson. Listen to the first words that Jesus speaks to this terrified crew, John 6:20. But he said to them, "It is I. Don't be afraid." Encountering the disciples, the first words that Jesus spoke was to what? Address their fear. He spoke to them. He said, "It is I. Don't be afraid." Now, this statement is actually the first of what is called the I am statements in John's gospel. Let me explain that. The rendering of the Greek phrase, "It is I," that is in English, the Greek means the I am. Now, the New Living Version says here, "Don't be afraid, I am," capital I, capital A, capital M, "I am here." Or literally, "Don't be afraid, the I am is here. Don't be afraid, Yahweh is here. Don't be afraid, the Almighty God, the God of all creation is here." Now, this phrase, the I am, is, of course, the sacred name by which God revealed himself to Moses in Exodus 3:14. I am who I am. Simply because God cannot be contained in any name. He is the I am. And we see this name used several more times in the coming chapter of John's Gospel as Jesus reveals his divinity. This passage of scripture teaches us, shows us that in the midst of our own struggles and toiling, Jesus knows the perfect time to come to you and whisper in your ear, "I am here. Don't be afraid." You see, one thing about Jesus, he's never early, but he's never a moment too late. His timing is always perfect, always. Matthew's gospel gives us some more information. It says, Peter called to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water." "Yes, come," Jesus said. Now, apparently, Peter is the only one, or maybe he was the first one to shout out. let's say he's the first one to react in what? Faith instead of fear. He's the first one to react in faith, and this impulsive request is going to give him the experience of a lifetime. You think maybe he should have thought this through before going over the side of the boat. But over the side of the boat, Peter went. And his feet hit the water. Wow! He didn't sink. He was standing on the water. Yes, there was waves. Yes, there was wind. But he was standing on the water. Wow! And I'm sure Peter thought, well, so far, so good. So this is good. So there's Jesus, and I'm going to start walking to him now. Amidst the wind, amidst the waves, whatever, I'm going to start walking to Jesus. Get my eyes on him. I'm heading there. All good. Peter begins to walk, eyes fixed on Jesus. Peter looks around. Big mistake. He looks around and he sees the boat is now a fair distance behind him. Oh, but there's still a fair distance to get to Jesus. And he looks at the boat being tossed by the waves. Now he feels the wind blowing against him. And he looks down at the raging sea. Is this real? Is this really happening? I'm in the middle of the lake. These waves and winds, this storm, is it really happening? It's pitch dark. And the text tells us that Peter became terrified. He was absolutely terrified at what he beheld. And then suddenly, what had been a firm surface for him to stand and walk upon now became fluid, and Peter now begins to sink. He's slowly sinking beneath the waves. He says, save me, Lord. Save me, Lord. And the next thing we see is the hand of Jesus reaching out to him. He took Peter's hand, and Peter came up and back and was able to walk on the water again, and they walked to the boat. And they both climbed in. Friends, that is one incredible experience. What we learn from this passage of Scripture, what we learn from Peter's experience in doing what he did, as of course, I think it's one of the greatest object lessons for believers of all time. It's simply this. When you're in the midst of a storm, when you're in the midst of a crisis, don't take your eyes off Jesus. Keep your eyes fixed, because if you start looking at the crisis, if you start looking at the problem, it will cause fear to rise in you. Friends, you need to fix your eyes upon Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. I love that beautiful hymn. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. So fix your eyes upon Jesus, not upon the storm. Well, Jesus and Peter are now in the boat, and I'm sure Peter is very relieved. And all the disciples are amazed at what they have seen. But friends, the supernatural event that is taking place is not over yet. Another miracle is about to occur. And sometimes people miss this in the reading of the text, and it's in the last verse we'll look at today, verse 21. Then they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. What does that mean? And immediately the boat was at the land where they were going? Friends, it means exactly what the text tells us. The moment Jesus entered the boat, which was just about in the middle of the lake, as we talked about, as soon as Jesus entered the boat, they were at their destination. Pastor Dave, are you saying that like in an instant, suddenly they were in the middle of the lake, and then suddenly they were at the shore? Is that what I'm saying? That's exactly what I'm saying. That's exactly what the text tells us. Friends, we are dealing with Jesus and the incredible miracles He is the I am. He is the Creator God. And he displayed to the disciples that he is Lord over creation. He's Lord over the storm. He has absolute power over the natural order. He has demonstrated that by walking on water. But then, as he gets into the boat, he demonstrates that he has power over time and space. And the boat made that final 3 miles in an instant, in the twinkling of an eye. And immediately, the boat was at the land where they were going. Brothers, sisters, we serve an awesome God. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords, and he is truly worthy of all our worship. We're going to stop there today. Read these verses again. Meditate on these verses. Think about these verses. And friends, if you're going through a storm, if there's a crisis in your lives or a friend's lives, share this passage of scripture with them. Let them know that Jesus is in the storm. Jesus is in the storm. Father, I pray for every person listening, Lord, that they would truly understand that these things, Lord, storms are natural parts of our lives. Lord, we all have them. We all have times of crisis. But Lord, help us through these times to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. Jesus, you began this journey with us. And Jesus, you will see each of us safely home. Thank you that you're committed to us, Lord, reaching that finish line. Lord, I ask you to bless, encourage, and stir every heart listening today. In your name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, God bless you. And Lord willing, we'll be back this time next week as we continue in John chapter 6. Until then, have a great week serving the Lord Jesus. Amen. God bless. Bye-bye for now.